So now you see that this quantity, what I have done is basically I have expressed it like some quantity here. So what is this? This quantity, if you look at this, this finally, this just needs a vector, right? So this is a matrix product, this is a matrix, and now this is a vector. This product, it gives you a vector, and this denominator is some constant. So this quantity is a vector, and now you are looking at its inner product with this quantity. Then it is like similar to what I was basically doing it here, right? But instead of d, I have replaced it by this entire quantity. Instead of this vector d, I have another quantity here. So if I want to now apply some bound, probability bound on this, like in this fashion the way I did, I need to just then consider this and then use whatever I have done here. But there is an issue here. When I did take this inner product here, right, this d is a particular arm, and I took the inner product on this error term here. But now here, this quantity whatever which I want to treat it as a d, it is not a fixed quantity, it is a random quantity. Why is that? Because theta hat has come into picture. So now if I want to apply any tail bound on this, like I want to consider what is the probability that this guy is going to be greater than less than or equals to beta, something of that sort, I can't directly use what I have done here, because here to do this I have to deal the projection of a random arm on my error term. So how to now account for the randomness in this quantity? Okay, so for that we have to do some more tricks, and that trick comes from something called covering argument. See, this quantity here is random, and this will lead to a column vector which could be any, it can take any possible value in my RD space, right? Because this theta hat is a random quantity, because of this, this quantity can be anywhere in my RD space. I don't know what is this value is, it depends on the value of theta t hat and also other quantities theta star and what was the matrix Vt at that time. So to do this, it can take all possible values, many possible values in the space Rd. We are going to first discretize these possible values and now try to focus on the discrete possible values. So this is, this can be any value in Rd space which could be like countably, uncountably large. So what we are going to do is, when we have such a situation, right, we usually go for and apply the union bound, right? We consider, so right now this quantity has become a random quantity for us because of this estimated term here. Whenever we have a randomness quantity, if you remember when we did it in the multi-arm banded, so you remember in the multi-arm banded, the number of the times R pulled is a random quantity, right? How did we, and when we wanted to apply Hofding singularity, how did we do it? We consider all possible values of the number of pulls and then took a union bound on that. So but there applying a union bound was okay, because the values taken by the number of pulls was only finite, that is 1, 2 all the way up to t. But here this quantity can take uncountably many values. So first what we are going to do is, we are going to discretize it, and then we are going to see that whatever possible value it can take, we are going to say that there exist a point in my discretized space which is going to be arbitrarily close to this. So, we will make that notion precise. And now, once we have discretized, we have only finitely many points in that set, and then we apply a union bound on that. So, what we mean by? So, we identify finite set C epsilon belonging to RD such that so let me call this entire quantity Y. For whatever value Y takes, there exist some Y belongs to C epsilon, that is epsilon close. So, what I mean by this? For whatever value of Y, there exists some Y such that this holds, where Y belongs to my C epsilon. So, understand this, what I mean by covering this? I am basically saying that, see, my set of points, that is the possible values Y can take, it could be uncountably many. Now, I want to make an approximation of this by a finite points such that whatever value this guy takes, there exists a point in my set such that that is going to be epsilon close to that value Y. That is, whatever value capital Y has taken, there exists a small y from my set C epsilon such that this difference is going to be less than epsilon. This is what basically I have done the discretization, right? Now, the question is whether such a C epsilon exists, and if at all it exists, and of course, that C epsilon I have denoted as with a subscript epsilon to mean that that depends on the size of epsilon. So, naturally, if you are expecting a small epsilon, what do you expect the size of C epsilon to be? It is going to be large, right? Okay, here is a lemma which says existence of such a covering set. So, I am going to denote a set first S of D to be such of it is X such that what is this set SD is saying? SD is such of all X such that their norm is less than or equals to 1. That means basically it is a unit ball in my dimension D. Okay. So now there exists a set C epsilon with cardinality of C epsilon were bounded by 3 epsilon to the power d such that for all x belongs to SD, there exist y belong to C epsilon such that you follow what is this lemma is telling? It is telling that if you have a unit ball, then that point that has that can have uncountably many points in that, right? Now we are saying that I can come up with a discretized version of that set which will have at most 3 by epsilon to the power d point, such that if you give me any point x in this unit ball, then I will have a corresponding y in my set C such that the difference is no more going to be epsilon. So that is basically you have, so this is your ball, let us say now you have discretized it with some finite number of points. Now we are saying that if you give me any point, let us say this is the point you are given, I will be able to come up with some point which is going to be within epsilon distance from that point. So I should be able to do it for any point given in my ball. I should be able to come up with some point from my discrete set such that this quantity happens. Okay, so this is true and we are just going to take this lemma. We are not going to prove this. Okay, so this is a and this is a pretty handy lemma to know. You can use it elsewhere also, like whenever you want to do a discretization, and by the loss we are going to incur by doing a discretization will be at most epsilon if your number of elements in your discretization is going to be this much. But one has to be also careful that how where this discrete point are going to lie. You can't assume that in this all my discretized point only lie in some small region. Then if I choose a point here, I will not be able to find a good approximation to that point. Okay, so of naturally this discrete response has to kind of cover this entire region. So that is why we are looking for a cover for this set, but that consists of only discrete finitely many points in it. Okay, fine. So now the question is, this lemma holds only for the case where my points, I can cover points which are coming from a unit ball, right? But now this set Y, whatever this Y, does this come from a unit ball? That is, whether this Y belongs to this set SD, it just Y, let us just compute. Just compute, let us see what this gives you. So this should be, what is this? This will give mu. So what is this? This is nothing but y with y itself, right? And of course there is a square term here. So if you just look into this, you will see that theta hat minus theta star into vt divided by theta t minus theta star whole divided by norm of vt, vt square root, right? It is. Let us see, I only want to take this part x. So let us leave this 1 vt to the power half. Okay, now just take this x. So now let us see whether my x, what is this x? Is this x going to lie in my unit ball? So just check that this guy x transpose x is going to be 1. Okay, and now this x entire thing. Okay, then I want you to check what is this quantity half of this x vt inverse. Can you check what is this quantity is going to look like? So this is nothing but the norm of x, right? This is again going to be 1. Okay, Okay, fine. So let's have this. Let's see. Okay, so I have these properties. So now let's come back to this. So if I'm going to denote this quantity as x, is that clear that this quantity is x transpose x is 1 and then Vt, the norm of this quantity is 1, yeah?
X transpose root of Vt transpose.
Okay, let's do this, right? What is this quantity? This quantity is X transpose,
yes.
Vt half
transpose.
Yeah. This is the numerator, right?
Vt
also there in this.
The root of Vt half,
yeah,
may not be symmetric.
Just see, what is the meaning of Vt half means every element is just being taken square root.
That's the basically Vt.
So this is right, xt Vt to the power half, Vt inverse Vt to the power half. Vt minus half, I can again split as Vt to the power minus half and Vt to the power minus half, right?
That's fine.
Yeah.
But this transpose Vt half.
Ah, okay.
Transpose, is it equal to Vt?
Yeah, is that true or not? So if original Vt is symmetric,
yes,
if you are going to, and every element is that in that positive or not? Not necessarily. So suppose, let's say first consider the case when every element is positive, and then I am going to define Vt to the power square root t. Then this is the same thing, right? This is again going to be symmetric.
This is positive definite.
Yeah.
Then we split it up into two matrices.
Okay. The question is, if Vt is symmetric.
Positive definite.
Yeah.
Only then this Vt half will be
equal. Right. It is. Anyway, Vt is positive definite for us. We already know that,
yes.
So we don't need to worry about it. And now the question is, what about Vt half? Is it the same? Okay, just if you are confused, just work it out, right, yourself. Okay, so right now let's take this is true, and that's why this holds for us. Okay, so let's continue. Now I want to use this. After doing this, now our goal is what? Our goal is to find out whether if I can bound such a probability, okay, if I have to use some beta there. Now I am going to show that if I have to define a set, we will see that there exists C belongs to C epsilon such that, now I want to do this set. Now see, what I am basically doing is, now I am looking for an event where I am looking for a presence of an x in the set CE. CE is now a finite set for me, which violates this condition, which in which this inner product is going to be larger than this. Okay, so this, if I want to look at the probability of this event, what is this? Can I write it as, or x coming from C epsilon, probability that Vt half x theta t hat minus theta star being greater than or equals to 2 log epsilon by delta. Is this correct? Okay. So I am interested in this event where I am looking for the existence of an x for which this condition holds. Then I can always this upper bounded by this quantity, right? Now everything x is deterministic. I am looking for one possible element in this discretized version. Now I already now I also know that this vt to the power half into x, where x is of this form, I already know this is as a norm of 1. Okay, that means this guy is this points here, they are already coming from a unit ball. The same vt I am taking there also, right? Vt to the power half.
The norm is with respect to vt
inverse. Just a minute, yeah, that's right. So earlier when we applied this result, right, what would we say? We took it any, so when we started with, we just started with saying that d inner product with some quantity, right? So d inner product with some quantity, and on so that was like projection of my arm d on the error. I was trying to bound that. So now this is, now whatever this quantity is, let us say this is now a vector, I am trying to project it on this, okay. And we had in the first step, we had demonstrated this, this can be written as a linear combination of my noise, and then I had applied a result to this quantity, right. So what would I show for this? So now this, all these quantities is deterministic, there is nothing randomness about this quantity x, okay. So now what is this probability is? I have shown you that if we have this quantity, we had earlier I had 1 by delta here, but now I have cardinality of C epsilon upon delta. So if you just go and work, this is going to be like x belongs to C epsilon. This is now nothing but delta upon 1 upon C epsilon. This probability is going to look like this. So I erased it, but whatever the bound we have earlier, if I am just going to look into that, we will have this quantity, and now this is nothing but equals to delta. So what now we have basically done is, suppose if I restrict, take a set CE which is like a discrete version of all the points that could have arise from points like y here. So on that, even if I have to remove the randomness here, how I am going to remove the randomness here? By considering all possible x's that are coming from my discrete set C which has only finitely many elements. Even if I do that, that quantity, that this probability of error is going to be still delta only. And now I have to now translate, okay, fine, this probability is upper bounded by delta, but there was an error when I went from points here to a discretized points in this set, right? Now we have to worry about that part as well. So now you will see that, okay, fine. So at this point I have not actually used that this guy has to be, this norm of this vector has to be 1. It can be any vector here, vt to the power half x can be any vector. Now for that we know this upper bound holds, okay. So now let us see where I am going to use the error part. Theta hat minus theta star. So this is another result I am going to write which you need to verify. So this equality holds. So I am just writing this right away, but you can verify this. I am just saying that norm can be written as, so this is going to be Vt here. This matrix norm can be written as a maximization problem over unit ball. Okay, so how is this? Please check.
Bounded by delta by mod c epsilon.
Yes.
So in the root 2 log c epsilon by delta thing,
yeah,
there should be some factor of which relates the norm of this.
Okay, so fine.
If we call this d, this vt half. This vt to the power half times x, if we call it d.
Yes.
So on the other side.
Yeah.
So there is some term which involves.
So that term earlier came because we are dealing with the summation there. Now that sum is not there on this part. If you now just carefully look into, we were there looking at summation for s 1 to t.
So s is 1 here.
Just one, well, yes, one term here. That is why this summation term has not appeared here.
I think this would become like norm of d vt inverse ds whole square.
That is what I am saying. So that was coming because it was making it not one sub-Gaussian noise, but that was the sub-Gaussian noise that was getting multiplied. The sub-Gaussian was getting amplified by that factor. And we had such many sum, we had a sum of that. But now you see that in that I am only dealing with one term here and there is no summation. Okay, so that is why I have to only deal with this. So this, the whatever you are saying, the factor that was coming after 2, that term is not there. So it is just the same thing, but instead of the summation, I am only looking at one term here. Just work it out, okay? So that is why it is still going to be lambda here. And now I am saying that take this inequality for granted. So notice that we had this state result and this result. We are just stating these. Okay, so we'll just take it for granted them. Now I am going to do quick manipulations. Okay, why is this so long? We're almost done. So now with this half, I'm just going to do this quantity plus. Okay, then I'm going to do it as Vt half times y comp theta hat theta. So what I have done here, I have simply this minimization is an artificial here because I have just subtracted y from x and added y quantity here. So this y has no effect on this, but I am just introduced it and trying to minimize it over this quantity. So these are the manipulations I need. Okay, now if you apply some Cauchy-Schwarz inequality on this quantity, what I am going to get? Theta t hat minus theta star vt and then x minus y square. Can I just quickly check this? This quantity, if I am going to apply Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, I am just going to get this inequality here. And then whatever the quantity that remains here, we already know that this quantity being greater than this quantity is very upper bounded by a small probability delta. So we are going to, with high probability, we are going to replace this quantity by this upper bound, which is okay. Now let's see this. What I will do is now, this quantity x here, we know that they were falling in a unit ball, right? So, and now this y's we have chosen, they are coming from a unit, a discretized version of this, the corresponding value of y. And see, I am taking a minimum here. So, I know that if I am going to, the minimum value I am going to get on this is going to be at most epsilon. So, now if I do this, this quantity is nothing but norm of theta t hat theta star vt, this is going to be epsilon, and then this is going to be 2 times log epsilon by delta, and now just get rid of this max term because now there is no more x here. And now let us try to plug in the quantity c of epsilon. What is the size of the c of epsilon? We know that the c of epsilon is at most upper bounded by 3 by epsilon to the power d. Okay. So, this quantity is so, what we have finally gotten is theta t hat minus theta t star of vt is upper bounded by this. So, if I am going to further simplify this quantity, what I will finally end up with is theta t minus theta star is vt. So, there is an epsilon here. If I take it on the other side, I am going to get 1 minus epsilon. I will simplify that, then I am going to end up with two log get this quantity, whole quantity, it is 2d log 3 by epsilon plus 2 log 1 by epsilon. And this is true for any epsilon I am going to choose, right? So you see that I have an upper bound on the difference between these two quantity, and this is going to hold with probability of at least 1 minus delta, because I have used this fact that this quantity being larger than this lower bounded as this quantity is delta. So, this quantity being upper bounded is going to be at most 1 minus delta. So, that is what I have done here. So, this quantity holds with probability at least 1 minus delta. And now, if this epsilon is what I have chosen, epsilon just told how I discretized my unit ball, right? So, if I am going to choose epsilon small, what is this quantity is going to be like? It is going to be large, right? But whereas this quantity, if I choose epsilon small, this epsilon comes in the denominator. So, this can shoot up. Okay. So, we have to choose epsilon appropriately, because one term there is a tension between these two terms here, right? In terms of epsilon, one guy is increasing and another guy is decreasing. So, how to choose epsilon appropriately? You can tune it appropriately, but let us say for time being we are going to just set epsilon equals to half, then you will see that. Yeah, this is 1 upon delta. will now see that this is upper bounded by, we just do this simplifications, I mean just replace this, we are going to get it as something half, this is going to be 2, this is going to be 2d log 6 plus 2 log of 1 by delta. So now you see that if my beta t is a beta capital T like has been chosen like this, then I know that my theta star is going to be satisfying this inequality. Okay, that means my theta star is the norm of this difference with respect to beta t is bounded by this with probability at least 1 minus delta. Now what we have basically demonstrated is if I am going to choose a beta in such factor, I can and look for a set CT. So how was my CT? Let us say if I just do this, and this quantity same thing here, which I am going to call it as some beta. I know that, so this is just theta. The theta star is going to lie in this set with probability at least 1 minus delta, right. So what we have basically demonstrated is through the sequence of steps under some assumptions, maybe very restrictive as of now, we will be able to come up with some beta t such that if I am going to look at this confidence ellipsoids, it is going to contain my true parameter theta star with high probability, and this is true for any t. Now the assumptions I made, they were mostly non-practical, right? Like I mean they are not plausible in the sense that I am not going to select an arm in a deterministic fashion without ignoring what has been observed. But if I am going to select an arm in each round observing what has been offered, the things are more complicated. There is more coupling that is going to happen because all the action you are going to choose, it has been based on all what has been observed, and further there is a coupling through this theta star which is common for every reward, all that has to be taken into care. But once you have to take into all those coupling, you have to still go and use some still sophisticated machinery. This machinery to use this, we have mostly used only simple linear algebra, and then we have exploited subgaussianity trail behavior, right. But now once we have bit more coupling of the rewards, we have to use the analysis that has been shown in the book that uses martingale properties and mixture methods, and then you can able to show that indeed even if you relax all the assumptions you made, it is still possible to come up with such a beta t here which will guarantee that you can come up with an ellipsoid which contains theta star in every round with high probability. And once that happens, we already know how to analyze, right. In the first class when we started this stochastic linear bandit, I already give a recipe how to get the regret bound if once we can construct this confidence ellipsoids. So there I had assumed how, let us say such a confidence ellipsoid exists, and then we showed a regret bound. Now we just demonstrated under restricted assumptions that yes, such a confidence ellipsoid indeed exists. But we can go further and say even under if you remove all the assumptions we have made in this, not all but few, we are still able to come up with confidence ellipsoids, and then once we have that, we also have the regret bounds. Okay, so I will leave you to read into that, that is bit more mathematical, I mean we will get easily lost with that. So just read how to apply the martingale properties. You need to have at least basic need to know what is the basic martingale is, that should be enough. I think rest is all algebra, just try to go into that. So the study of stochastic linear bandits will stop here, but now what we do is from the next class is we will continue to study linear bandits, but now we will go with the reverse gear and we will go back to adversarial setting. So you remember we started studying adversarial bandits, then we have shifted to stochastic bandits. Now we continued study of stochastic bandits for the linear setting, but now we will go back to study this linear bandits for the adversarial case in the next class. Okay, yeah, let's stop here.